Glad you're with me. I would be much more boring on my own. So, Teresa, thank you for being here with us. We're happy you had a short commute since this is home for you.
I love it. Love Washington, D.C.
It's a boring town.
Yeah, totally.
So for those of us who aren't fully steeped in government procurement processes and the DoD's JEDI project, what is the JEDI project? Can you just explain?
Well, first of all, thanks for having me, and it's amazing to be here with all these other women. And I'm totally shocked that everyone doesn't understand government procurement. But JEDI is a $10 billion contract that the Department of Defense has put out. It's called a warfighter contract, and it's the first time they've gone out for an enterprise-wide capability for a new technology that really supports the warfighter at the edge for mission. So it's very different. A lot of these are kind of back office and they're large IT contracts, but this is really considered a warfighter contract. So it's significant, and it's a new kind of model they're looking to drive.
10-year, $10 billion contract. Give an example of what does a warfighter cloud or contract mean? What kind of applications will this enable?
Well, one of the reasons this is different, if you think about a warfighter, they need information in real time. And in kind of an old model today, they've had to be, it takes them a long time to get information that they need because they would have to buy tools and wait for them to get them. And when you're in the field and you're in dangerous areas and austere areas around the world, you can have, as an example, you need information dissemination. So you need the ability to rapidly pull in and process data and analyze it and get it to the warfighter so they can do something with it. And today, because of the amount of data and how much comes down is being processed, if you think about unmanned vehicles overhead or drones that are looking at things, there's a lot of information flow coming from that. And if they can't process and decide what to do with that information quickly, the other area is continuous communications or resiliency of communications. So if satellites, many times in the field for warfighters, their satellites get jammed, or communications networks get cut, then cloud computing allows them to have that continuous level of communication. And a third area, Michal, would be like training and maintenance, where they have continuous information about fleets, so they know what's working, what's not, and then just virtual and real-time training. And it's critical for them to have these capabilities at all times.
This all sounds like something that we would think already existed, but doesn't at DoD. Why is that?
Well, DoD, for some of you who may not know, the U.S. Department of Defense spends more money on IT than anyone in the world, by far. And you have, again, like I said, IT capabilities, and then you have mission. And mission trumps everything in government, as it should, just in business. But the old model of IT is one where you go out and you buy a bunch of servers and you buy things that you don't always need and kind of hope you have what you need. Cloud computing is still fairly new. It's not new to startups. Most of the companies you've heard here, they begin their companies and build and sustain. They don't know, they're cloud native, we call. They just build their tools in cloud. Well, governments around the world, most of them, have old, very outdated legacy systems. And part of it is because of what you just said. The procurement processes are long, laborious, and they get protested all the time. So it takes a very long time. And in the past, governments have tended to do these really long contracts without continuous innovation built in. So now they're trying to make this shift. So old legacy for a very long period of time, now they're really going through a modernized approach to how they're actually procuring and using technology, which must be done in the United States of America. It's got to be done.
So speaking of the laborious process, this one has been particularly complicated with plenty of awesome twists and turns. Talk a little bit about sort of who were the players early on and what has it been whittled down to and what's the current status?
Okay. So the DoD today, it's kind of been reported that they have about 500 cloud projects in the works. But like I said, this is the first big warfighter one over a long period. So there were four bidders originally, which was AWS, Microsoft, IBM, and Oracle that we know of.
Like some AWS being
Amazon Web Services. And it's down to two now. It's down, they kind of down selected to two, which is Microsoft and Amazon Web Services. Mm-hmm. And we're waiting.
And Oracle was happy with that.
Oh, totally. Completely. Yeah, you can see that. No, they were not happy. They protested it, which is not unusual, by the way. I know you ladies, I'm excited that you want to know about government contracting. I'm sure it's a riveting topic, but it does affect all of us on a daily basis as much as it's kind of hard to dive into. We should all actually be really concerned about this, but it is kind of a status quo in government that everything gets protested, which is kind of sad because it delays innovation. Mm-hmm. And one of the things, Michal, that we've done at AWS, I came to Amazon in 2010 and started our public sector business for Andy and Jeff. And the reason was, we said, governments and citizens deserve the same type of technology as any startup. And our role has been to provide the governments around the world, the US and others, with technologies that help them move faster and have those innovative capabilities built in better, faster, less expensive, with security by design.
So it is definitely true that these kind of contracts get contested all the time, and that's the status quo. But is it unprecedented, the level to which this particular contract has become politicized?
Well, I've been working in public sector for a little over 20 years now. And I have seen a lot of these. Sometimes they're not as always out there in the press, but there are a lot that kind of will get political. For tankers, aircraft carrier, I mean, there's been a lot of things because this is big business. Like I just said, DoD spends more money than anyone else in the world on information technology. And when you're trying to go into a shift, a lot of people don't want change. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the vendors that are in there, they don't want change. Because change means that somebody's moved their cheese and they potentially won't have the same type of business as they had before. But that's innovation. That's what we all do, is compete every day. So yeah. It is, it has been out there a lot. I will have to admit, even for me, I was shocked. I was like, oh wow, this contract. But when you consider it's such a massive shift, that's the reason. Because you're going from on-premises, lots of dollars spent, a lot of these vendors, to a move to the cloud for a lot of mission capabilities, which we need.
So, and just to give a little bit more context, one of the allegations, I guess, or the concerns that have been brought up on the part of your rival bidders, at least earlier on in the process, was that the process was rigged in favor of Amazon, and things have been brought up like you meeting with Mattis and all sorts of other things, and there's like this crazy chart that was drawn with hearts and whatever, connecting Amazon executives with government and DoD. And so, I mean, I'm guessing I know what your answer is, but I mean, was there any wrongdoing? Was the process rigged?
No, the process was not rigged.
I'm
sure. Because if
again, you said you were going to break news here tonight.
Yeah, I wish I had a crystal ball, actually. I wish I had a crystal ball. But this was one of the most complicated. I've been doing procurements for years. My team, I think we did 15,000 different procurements on my team just this last year that we bid for. This is the most complex one I've ever seen in my career. I mean, I really mean that. But I think the reason that some legacy providers were worried is that in 2013, AWS won the intelligence community cloud. And people were shocked. I mean, I've heard people say it was kind of the shot around the world. They're like, what? How did they win that? But the intelligence community had already been looking for cloud computing capabilities. And when we won that and we built it and we have sustained that, the intelligence community is doing amazing things with their innovation. So we've built clouds at every classification level, from unclassed to top secret to secret. And we have experience. Mm-hmm. We have that experience. And I think that is the reason people saw it was working and they're like, well, Amazon's just gonna win this because it's working.
How many of you, by the way, knew that Amazon runs the CIA's cloud? Raise your hand, show of hands. Okay.
This is not the case in every audience, I'm sure. That doesn't surprise me.
So another concern that has been raised is that is the fact that DoD is going with a single vendor. Why not multi-vendor? Wouldn't that actually help bubble up more innovation and increased security?
Well, if you go back to 2013, why did the intelligence community to make the decision for to do a single cloud? It was because they don't have the capabilities they need of training and education yet. And you know, we can't underestimate, moving to the cloud is complicated when you're moving old legacy systems. Mm-hmm. And when you're asking an untrained force of people to get trained on multiple clouds with multiple security configurations, that makes the warfighter's job more complicated, not easier. Mm-hmm. So I personally think they're making the right decision because they need one enterprise-wide model for this to actually, now over time they can add tools, and by the way, they'll have multiple companies and partners on top of whatever cloud they choose, so it won't just be one group. And if you look at DoD today, they're not single cloud. They have, like I said, 500 cloud projects.
They have other clouds, but these are different clouds. For the warfighter cloud, this is single vendor.
For warfighter, this is one, but they kind of tried to make out that DoD will only have this one, which is not the case. They already have projects. My team, we work on multiple projects today in DoD, but for this one, it is the right thing because they need a single enterprise solution that they can build on and learn and scale. And that's the way they should get started. I still believe that is the right thing for them. Whatever vendor they choose, whatever partner they choose, I think it's the right thing for them.
Okay. And let me ask you real quick also, because we can't have this conversation without talking about President Trump. This has become politicized. The president retweeted a story calling this contract and the bidding process the Bezos bailout. He repeatedly refers to the Washington Post as the Amazon Washington Post, and everybody knows that there's a beef there. How has that complicated this process from your perspective?
Well, like I shared, I've been doing this for 20 years, and my team and myself running the public sector, we always look at the long term, not the short term, and we want to build solutions that outlast all of us and that we give and we put technologies in the hands truly of our citizens, warfighters, and the public servants that are required. Mm-hmm. And we kind of have to get beyond all this. I know that sounds maybe strange, Michal, but you can't dwell on this stuff. And I will have to say, a lot of people may not know this, but this administration has actually driven a lot in the IT modernization area. So for cloud, as an example, we've seen customers across government adopt cloud at a much faster rate during this administration than ever before. In the Obama administration, a good friend of mine, Vivek Kundra, started. He was the first CIO of the federal government, and he started this process. But really, this administration has taken, they have a very effective IT modernization policy, and we are seeing a broad adoption there.
So what you're saying is you don't mind the president calling it the Amazon Washington Post. No,
you've always heard Jeff say, I think people in this room have heard Jeff say, if you are a public company, you have to be scrutinized. It's okay, and you have to take that feedback and learn from it and do the best you can. And like I said, we have to build things that are outlasting us, and we can't just focus on these kind of political little things that happen all the time.
Okay. Well, I wanted to get to a lot more, but I'm so sorry we have to wrap up. Thank you so much for being here with us,
Teresa. Thank you, ladies. Thank you.